to talk about conjugate work for raw lifters. This is one of my favorite training subjects and one of my least favorite training subjects. It's one of my favorites because I love the conjugate method. I think it's so smart and has so much potential. It's one of my least favorite topics because there are so many idealists out there that I think overlook the bigger picture and are just kind of, they overlook the bigger picture and instead they get fixated on the right way of doing things. And if you guys have been following me for a long time, you know I firmly believe there is no right way of doing things. There's ways that work for you, there's ways that don't work for you. And the conjugate method in particular provides a ton of opportunities to figure out what works for you. Plus, it's fun. Fun is always good. So today we're going to look at some options that you have as a raw lifter for programming using the dynamic effort method. If you guys aren't already familiar with this, go to Westside Barbell, read up on some of the basics. But essentially, dynamic effort work is your light work. It's designed to train the speed of the lift with the idea that you can lift a light weight faster, you can lift a heavier weight faster as well, and therefore more weight, essentially. Again, I know some people are really going to nitpick that, and please don't, because it's not important. It's really not. All you have to think about is, okay, my dynamic effort work, I'm going to be trying to get in a light workout with a lot of volume, moving the bar as fast as possible, and moving my body as quickly as possible in between sets, not lagging around a lot. So we're going to watch some speed pulls that I did a while back, and I'm going to explain as I go through some of the things that you need to keep in mind. Okay, when you're looking at programming, the two main variables you're going to start with, volume and intensity. Volume, how many total reps are you doing? Intensity, what percentage of the one rep max are you using? Typical recommendations for deadlifts for dynamic effort work, you're usually going to be using about 45 to 55% of your one rep max for 8 to 12 singles, roughly thereabouts, okay? Now, Westside uses a lot of accommodating resistance, typically. Typically, when you see the conjugate method used, you'll see deadlifts done for singles with bands and chains, like I have here. I think chains are useful for anyone. Chains are a nice way to overload the top part of a movement if you're weak there. Bands, I don't like for a couple reasons. The biggest one is that they artificially change your bar path. To push up against that bar, I have to push up against that band. I have to keep the bar straight, and that's a good thing to practice. But at the same time, if you get used to that as kind of like a crutch, because that's the only way you perform your competition movements, I think it can be detrimental. You feel kind of lost without those bands almost. So the reason I have those very light mini bands on is so that I have that incentive to pull hard, right? Because the tension is going to accommodate. It's going to get harder at the top. That's the point of using the resistance bands. And it's kind of like a mental cue for me to outrace that tension. But that's all. It's primarily mental, not physical. It's not adding enough tension to really be physical. If you want to do that, if you want to use a lot of accommodating resistance, just follow the Westside template. But I don't recommend it for raw lifters because of that primarily that bar path reason. Also because if you misjudge and use too much accommodating resistance, it gets really, really hard. And you can burn yourself out on what's supposed to be a light day very, very quickly. So I'm sticking with the roughly the percentage of the one rep maximum that I'm supposed to use. I have a little bit of bands and chains there. Honestly, that's more for fun. I think the bands and chains total probably add 100 pounds. So you're looking at roughly 455 pounds, roughly 55% of my one rep maximum. Okay? Total. Look at how fast I'm moving the bar. Look at how fast I'm moving in between reps. That's what I want you all. Look, I'm getting psyched up for 455. That's because I'm trying to move as fast as I possibly can, and that's very, very important. No matter who you are, raw, equipped, whatever. But if you're not, I think more often raw lifters lack that maximum acceleration because they're used to grinding. Grinding is a lot more common because the groove is a little bit less important. In equipped lifting, if you're out of groove, you're missing lift, guaranteed. And in raw lifting, it's not always the case. You see a lot of people get out of the groove and grind through anyway. And so this is about practicing the perfect groove, going as fast as possible. All right? The third thing is volume. I'm only doing 8 singles here because of the way that it's incorporated into my program. But in general, if you're a raw lifter, I think you need to almost double the volume that you got that's recommended by Westside, okay? So I would be looking somewhere in the 15 to 20 rep range for total singles, assuming you're using this as your primary loading method, primary light day for deadlift. You know, if you're pulling 3 days a week, it's going to be different. If you're squatting 3 days a week and pulling twice like I am now, it's going to be different. So you got to adjust. You got to find what works for you. But in general, I would err on the side of more volume. This is something that Matt Wenning recommends. It's something that Mike Hedleski recommends. And it's something I recommend as well. So those are the basics, volume and intensity. You can get a little bit more complicated with it. Matt Wenning suggests that you use velocity tracking to be able to regulate the amount of weight that you have on the bar, or at least your amount of total weight. He recommends very, very high speeds for raw lifters. The problem with that is that it's difficult to obtain a velocity tracker, and even if you have one, from personal experience, they can be a pain in the ass to set up all the time, and the data's not always that consistent. So I'm not a huge fan of that method. Mike Hedleski, I'm probably butchering his name, but he suggests a time limit for your total number of sets, and I prefer that just for simplicity's sake. You know, Mike suggests, I think, 17 minutes or something like that to get through all your dynamic sets. This took me 6, you know, to get through 8 singles here. So, and if you look at the SSPT guys, Matt Gary and Susie Hartwig are phenomenal lifters. They also have a chart for how long you should take between sets. That's based on the percentage one rep max you're using, but it's generally fairly quick, so maybe 30, 45 seconds between reps and sets. And I think that's a pretty good starting point. Again, it's just a starting point. You have to find what works for you, and the only way you can do that is experiment. And I strongly suggest for dynamic effort work, you start experimenting by starting with what feels too light, too easy, and moving too fast. And I think you start there, give it some time to see if you notice any carryover to your other lifts. And if you do, great, you're golden. If you don't, start making some of those adjustments. You know, start playing with the volume, start playing with the intensity. I would start with volume. You know, start by increasing your volume, then try and maybe set a time limit for yourself with that volume. And then if that doesn't work, you know, start increasing the intensity and adding more weight to the bar. But I think that's a pretty solid template for incorporating speed work into your program. It does not have to be a Westside program, and in fact, if you're not training using the conjugate method, I recommend that you start not by using the conjugate method, but by incorporating speed work into your own program as a substitute for your light day. There's one more really important part of dynamic effort workouts that I want to address, and that's the use of the repetition method. So again, you go back to the Westside stuff, which is really the foundation of conjugate training. And you'll see they put a lot of emphasis on the repetition method, even though it's not maybe as sexy as the ME or DE methods. But essentially, the repeated effort method is just your basic bodybuilding assistance, okay? And I've covered that ad nauseum, but it's very, very important that you incorporate that because you're using very low percentages of your one rep max for this speed work. And so you need to be training at higher levels of effort, I think, at least as part of your workout, and you use the repetition method as your opportunity to do that, okay? So, you know, whether you're doing dumbbell bench press, flies, curl, I don't care. Choose exercises. I've been over this. Go see my other videos on assistance work. Just make sure you incorporate that into your dynamic training days as well, or you probably won't get enough work even on your light sessions, okay? So, again, just very basics about how to incorporate this method of training into your own programming. I recommend you start basic. You can get so complicated with this stuff, and I think that's the way to get lost in the rabbit hole, so to speak. So start basic, go from there, small adjustments, and find what works for you. Do not feel like you're stuck with that 45 to 55% recommendation for 8 to 12 sets of 1 to 3 reps, okay? It's a great starting point. It's not the be-all, end-all. That's all I got. Post the questions below and I'll do my best to answer.